Dr. Sanuj for all those kind words, and at the outset I am extremely thankful to Dr. Anuj, Dr. Murthy and Dr. Panda having me here to this wonderful city. I think we met after almost 2 years, so it was a wonderful opportunity to be part of this conference. Task assigned to me is digital healthcare, a boon in disguise during the pandemic. So we all know last 2 years, I said we couldn't have a physical meeting thanks to a pandemic which has been around, one of the worst medical fraternity and everyone has seen. It is for the first time I realized that even with wonderful science, you might have reached on the moon with a manless mission, but still a virus can undo everything. Possibly for the first time, we will all, even as doctors, we were handicapped and looking towards the nature, towards the God for a divine help. So I think this is for the first time that digital healthcare became all the more important. And that is what I think Dr. Panda wanted me to talk about, that it's a blessing in disguise or a boon in disguise during this pandemic. Slide. It's not moving. Just see, slide is not moving either way. So flow of my session will be first to introduce what is telemedicine, how telemedicine projects both globally and internationally and India-wise are going on. What are the modes of communication whenever we use a telemedicine consultation guidance, which are now thankfully already in place. Laws which are going to govern us during the telemedicine practice also, and the advantages and of course the barriers in telemedicine. It is for the first time, once I was reviewing this article, I realized that telemedicine is not new. It is not in last 5 years or 10 years. It was there almost a century earlier also. And today telemedicine is defined as an enabler of healthcare access and affordability. And we know as we are in a pandemic, providing in-person healthcare is extremely challenging, what has happened over the last 3 years. So it comes to be very cost-saving, especially in rural patient. While sitting in your chamber in a hospital, you may do a teleconsultation for someone who is at a very distant place in a rural area. So it also prevents the transmission of infectious diseases, reducing the risk of both healthcare workers and the patient. That means even we are also safe sitting in our chamber, and so is our patient. They don't have to physically visit us. So they are also scared of visiting us because of COVID-19 pandemic. Thankfully, 2020 March itself, for the first time, IMA and NMC or Medical Council of India, to ICMR, they have done that India's digital health policy is already in place, and it now advocates the use of digital tools for improving the efficiency and outcome of healthcare systems, and telemedicine guidelines are already in place. This is what I was referring to, history of telemedicine. I realized that even in the 20th century, ECG was transmitted over telephone almost 100 years ago. 1959, for the first time, a tele-video consultation was carried out on neurological examination. And even in 1985, Mexico City earthquakes, and subsequently 1988 also, another earthquake in Soviet Armenia, there also telemedicine has been practiced as a tool for helping the patients and reaching them out. So there is a very strong, this is what we are now realizing, that 70% of Indian population are still living in rural areas who may not have any access to healthcare systems or to the delivery. Unfortunately, it's a reverse paradigm. 90% of the secondary and tertiary center exists still in the metros or larger towns, while 70% of population, they are still living in the rural areas. This is then which it leads to low penetration of healthcare services. Unfortunately, there are very poor investors in rural areas. So there are inadequate medical facilities in rural areas. So the problem of retaining doctors, so even if you create an infrastructure in a rural area, you may not have doctors who are specialists or super specialists serving there. So the features of telemedicine are that doctors can choose the medium of teleconsultation based on professional judgment. This is extremely important, whether it has to be a video consultation, an audio, or just a text-based communication, that has to be decided by the doctor after going through the history of the patient or the initial investigation which patient might have sort of shared with you. But doctor has to maintain the same standard of care during teleconsultation. So it is not to be taken as lightly that you are just doing a teleconsultation while traveling, while you are on airport. You have to see to it that you do justice to that, because you are equally unable to any sues or malpractices problems later on. So patient is responsible for the accuracy of information. This responsibility lies with the patient, because until unless they come out with every detail, with every information, you may not be able to reach to a correct diagnosis. So if you are sort of happy to help the patient, till patient comes out with the detailed information, you may not be able to help the patient. And of course, if it is a handicapped patient, incapacitated patient, or a minor, there even a caregiver could be deemed as a authorized person who can have that teleconsultation. The major areas of telemedicine are teleconsultation. It could be telediagnosis, which is being practiced for almost 10 years now. We know teleradiology, teleophthalmology we are doing. Recently, one of my paper got accepted in IJJDC. It is near print. We had teleophthalmology through our fundal camera, a data of almost 3,090 patients. And we tried to compile that, how much of them had diabetic retinopathy, pre-proliferative and background diabetic retinopathy. And it's only 7% patient we had to refer finally to the retina specialist. So we said that if you practice teleophthalmology through a fundal camera in your own center, patient sitting at a distant place, they may not have to visit again, because if it is a simple background diabetic retinopathy, you may reassure that after 1 year, we may review it again. Similarly, tele-education and tele-training, this is a hybrid conference. While we are sitting here, we are getting experts' opinion. We are getting their sessions across the globe, and we are also delivering the same content to the people, those who have logged in as delegates. So this is what is tele-education and tele-training. There could be a tele-monitoring. Many patients these days are using gadgets. They can share their data, AGPs and everything, and that can be shared with a healthcare provider. And you can always do a tele-support system also. So telemedicine projects, I told you, globally and in India-wise, a lot of projects are already operational through All India Institute of Medicine, Jipmer, Pondicherry, and Chandigarh also. And they are running that Pan-African e-network project also. And many SAARC telemedicine networks are already in place. Well, this is an old slide, 2009, Dr. Anoop Mishra data, where he has tried to compile all those centers who are already in telemedicine practice in India. The modes of communication, I told you, this has to be decided after going through the history or the details of the patient, whether it will be a video consultation. If it is a skin problem, obviously you need to see the patient. So it may not be audio, may not be able to help you there. Many times or there may not be a good signal. So you may sacrifice a video consultation and do only simply a audio consultation, because then you may be able to hear the patient better. Or it can be simply text-based. Many a time patient may not have a good network. So they may just SMS their details, like chat Dr. Ashish has shown, something like that, and you may be able to help the patient. That is also counted as a teleconsultation. So for video-based telecommunication, of course, you require a good telemedicine facility, a good network, maybe a platform. It could be simply through an app. It could be simply through a WhatsApp video call, or many chat platforms these days are available, or you could use even Skype or even FaceTime. Audio telecommunication, again, it could be simply through a simple call, through a WhatsApp call, or through platforms which are now available for telemedicine practice. Text basis, again, you might create an active electronic diaries on smartphone, which can be shared immediately. And advantage is that you can collect that data, and a decision making can be done by healthcare professional immediately once they get that data shared on their maybe on phone or maybe on iPad. This is DTMS, which Dr. Jyoti Dev, we know, is the man who is probably an icon with the technology in this country from Trivandrum. He runs this diabetes telemedicine system for almost 10-15 years. He has been running it very, very efficiently. What it does is that a diabetologist is in touch, then you get the records from the patient, you review the record, prepare a prescription, and that is shared with the patients along with the counseling, maybe a diet consultation or a health counselor can be attached. And then patient creates his own SMBG, his own diary, which maybe then shared through a smartphone, and for the next review consultation, you might be able to do more justice to the patient. There are now, thankfully, consultation guidance, because once it has been approved by IMA as well as Medical Council of India, obviously law has to be there. There has to be a proper guidance, lest people get in the future in some trouble. It could also be today used as an emergency services to provide simply first aid. A patient might call you as a diabetic patient that I have symptoms suggestive of hypoglycemia. So first thing is you tell them that you take 15 gram of glucose, repeat your sugar after 15 minutes. You are still not well. You still repeat it once. If you are having a glucagon kit at your home, someone may inject. So it may be simply used to provide a first aid. Similarly, someone can telling you that I have retrosternal discomfort or a pain which might be suggestive of angina. So you can always guide your patient, and it could come out to be a life-saving measure for that particular patient. Again, it can also be used for providing counseling and advice on referral. Moment you realize that after two boluses of carbohydrate, patient has not improved, that is the time you should immediately use your third sense that this patient should be admitted. It may not be simply hypoglycemia. Maybe hypoglycemia has triggered a TIA or a stroke or acute coronary event. So in all cases of emergency, patient must be advised for in-person interaction. This is must. This responsibility you legally hold. If you have just treated the patient on teleconsultation, tomorrow something goes wrong, patient is going to sue you that I had a stroke and you told me it was simple hypoglycemia. There you must document that you must go for a physical examination to a nearest general physician or to a casualty or to an emergency room to get the correct diagnosis and the treatment, because once you have done that judiciously, you are safe. So it could be a first consult or a follow-up consult. First means when patient is coming to you for the first time. So if it is being initiated on the part of the patient, obviously the consent is already there. If you are initiating as a healthcare provider, someone, one of your friend called you that there is a patient who is in problem and you called that patient, then you must have an explicit consent. Because until and unless patient gives a written, a verbal or a text-based consent, it will not be taken as a true teleconsultation. A first consult will be when patient is consulting you for the first time. Even if same patient with the same illness, say diabetes uncontrolled, consults you after 6 months, again it comes out to be as a first consultation. It cannot be taken as a review consultation, because review consultation is when it happens with the same illness within 6 months. So even if patient is following you but comes to you with a different illness within 6 months, it is again taken as a first consult. So a first consult, a review consult which happens within 6 months with the same illness, a review consult which happens after 6 months will be taken as a first consult, a review consult with the different illness. Today he is coming to you with a viral fever, with a COVID-like illness, even if he is your known patient of type 2 diabetes, it will be again taken as a first consult. So these things are very, very important. Now, to choose a mode of consultation, I told you options are video, audio, text, chat-based, or email, WhatsApp, maybe Facebook, or so many other platforms are these days available. But most important thing is that you must identify your patient, especially if it is a first consult. You must know whom you are going to provide that consultation. And once you have placed that person, correctly place that patient, only then you should start the consultation. And consent, I told you, either it is an implied consent if patient has initiated it, or it will be an explicit consent if you are yourself, you are contacting the patient. So once you have done that, same thing has to be followed even in the follow-up telemedicine visit, because then again, you have to follow the same thing. You must sort of place that patient, identify that patient that this patient is a review consultation, and only then you should start consultation. It is always good that you introduce yourself also to that patient so that everything is correctly placed, lest you mismatch an identity and you give a wrong prescription to someone else. The prescription lists are zero, means any drug can be like an over-the-counter drug. A is when you are prescribing it for the first time on a video consultation, something like an antifungal for tinea cruris or ciprofloxacin eye drops. Obviously, it has to be on a video consultation. And then B is when it is a follow-up visit. Certain drugs are approved for a follow-up visit, like antihypertensive, you want to step up, you want to have hydrochlorothiazide or a combination. or you may step up OHAs. This will be B category drugs, which can be prescribed, and prohibited categories are which you cannot prescribe even on a teleconsultation. Documentation of your consultation is extremely important. You must maintain records and documents for almost 15 years. This is your legal responsibility. Even if it has been done only as a single consultation, you owe that responsibility. That record must be maintained either in your e-records or somewhere, and it has to be documented. Of course, you can charge any reasonable amount the way you have been charging for a physical visit. Just a word about law governing telemedicine because of paucity of the time. Let's just finish in 2 minutes' time. Telemedicine practice guidelines, fortunately, now are in place. I told you, March 25th, 2020, it has now been approved. So a digital health policy advocates the use of a digital tool for improving the efficiency and outcome of the healthcare system. In fact, government is encouraging so that you can reach to a rural area with the same amount of expertise. Dr. Anuj is sitting in Lucknow. He may not be able to reach to everyone, but if you get a consultation through a tele platform, you might be able to deliver the same expertise even at a very distant place. This is how it happened in COVID, that we were getting even patients from abroad, many of our own family members, and here and there, they are consulting from outside, and they still want to continue because they were happy you delivered them a good care. So there are laws which are governing that as early as 1940, then 56 IMA, 2010 Indian Medical Council, and 20 was an establishment, and recent 2020 guideline I told you by MCI. For the issuance of a medical prescription, 1940, it was that you must examine that patient. Thankfully, for the first time, MCI recognized that that may not be possible in this pandemic. So they have changed it. They said that if you are doing a teleconsultation, following everything, all SOPs in place, it stands as a true consultation. So there are rules which are going to govern this conduct and misconduct of a registered medical practitioner. Issues relating to patient-doctor confidentiality is extremely important because this responsibility lies on you or on your infrastructure. If you're doing from your own center, it is your responsibility. If you're doing through a hospital platform, it involves many more people because there could be a privacy issue. There could be leakage of information. Last slide. Leakage of information from your platform to an insurance company, to a drug company, a pharma company. So hospital setting or room of teleconsultation, there you should see to it that there is no leakage. It could happen from your hard drives. It could happen from your USB ports or from even from the printed material. Then patients have all the rights to sue you because they must have the confidentiality to get treatment. Choose a doctor like a physical consultation. They have a right to go for a second opinion. For a compensation, they can go to a grievance cell and all that. And of course, civil, criminal, and vicarious negligence will still hold true. Reimbursement also is now getting defined that fortunately, this may come soon that these teleconsultation will be reimbursed also. There are challenges by the physician. Of course, you need to have a good infrastructure, a expertise how to handle that infrastructure, and of course, a good network. There are challenges on telemedicine because of network issue, then literacy, many patients may not be well aware. So to conclude, there are going to be an advantages. It is going to have an improved access to information. Provision of care, not previously deliverable, but that is fortunately, I told you, now everything has been approved. It is very effective and safe method. And in the long run, this is what is our paper that we said that if it is through a fundal camera, it costs you less than 500 rupees. In Delhi, any retina opinion costs you at least 1500. So it comes out to be very reasonable for the patient, and it is ultimately going to reduce the cost of that. So it is absolute need of the hour. Most important thing is a data protection, which lies with you. You, of course, will involve all stakeholders. Then only probably this will be flourishing. And it has to be a strong, dependable, easy to use platform. It has to be archivable, and legal protection is extremely important. Upgradable from time to time as features get added. And it has to be, of course, regulatory approved. It is already approved, but subsequently more and more things are getting incorporated into that. Thank you very much, sir.